students. Continuing with the video lectures, today I bring before you an important topic, the First Anglo-Sikh War. Now, before I talk about this, I would like to tell you that what are we going to talk about in this war? Right. Number one, I'll be discussing the causes, I'll be discussing the course or the events, the result and the treaties. And don't miss my last slide where I have a special map for you to talk about the events or where these battles were fought. Now, whenever we talk about the Anglo-Sikh War, the First Anglo-Sikh War, there are two things to be remembered. One, the Governor General during this time period was Lord Hardinge. Number two, it was not after the First Anglo-Sikh War that Punjab was made the part of the British Empire. Now, we have to understand before we go on to start the details of this war, that during the 18th and the early years of 19th century, the tide of the British expansion had now covered almost the entire subcontinent and now was stretching to the borders of Punjab. Now, you know, this kind of scenario that where British were looking towards Punjab greedily was also witnessed or also kind of felt by Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Now, the great Sikh leader Maharaja Ranjit Singh had developed his military forces to thwart any British advance to the kingdom north of River Satluj. Yet, the death of Ranjit Singh unraveled the unworthy successors, the desperate forces who fought over the legacy, while East India Company seized the opportunity and prepared for this battle. So let's talk about the causes first. See, whenever we talk about the causes, let's first just look at the entire causes. Let me have my pen as well. Right. See, one is the British policy of encircling Punjab, then is the anarchy in Punjab, then is defeat of British in the First Anglo-Afghan War, occupation of Sindh by British, policy of the Governor General towards Punjab, military preparation by British, appointment of Major Bradford. देखो कहीं पर Bradford भी लिखा हुआ है, कई books में they've written Broadfoot also. So I think the real one is Bradford. That's what I feel, how many books I've read. But of course, in I was just trying to find out on the internet, the Broadfoot word has also been used. Then the affair of Mohra village, incitement to war by Lal Singh and Ten Singh. So now the question comes that how do we attempt this question or how do we kind of, you know, do this particular portion? See, whenever we do the causes, Abisko causes obviously we'll be doing in detail, but just try to remember these, you know, broad points. And once you remember these broad points, the rest is your understanding. So let's quickly do these points again. One, the British policy of encircling Punjab. Number two, anarchy in Punjab. Defeat of the British in the First Anglo-Afghan War. Occupation of Sindh by British. Policy of British Governor General towards Punjab. The military preparations by British. Appointment of Major Broadfoot or the Bradford affair of Mohra village. Incitement of war by Lal Singh and Ted Singh. Right. So we will start with these, you know, with these causes one by one. So the first cause that we talked about is the British policy of encircling. Now, what does it mean? See, they tried to kind of encircle Punjab in such a way that it becomes easy for them to annex and it becomes difficult for Punjab to get any kind of help. Now, dekho, when we start with this, number one, we'll be talking about the Treaty of Amritsar. Right? We know that British had been looking towards Punjab and they wanted to bring Punjab under their control. It all started in 1809. We did that in the Anglo-Sikh relations. Now, in 1809, River Satluj, if you can just see the green lined this line. This River Satluj became the dividing line between the areas of Ranjit Singh and British. Now, it doesn't mean that the entire South came under British. In fact, South of Satluj came under the protection of Ranjit Singh, but even here there were certain areas from which Ranjit Singh continued to get the revenue, right? So, and another word that you need to remember is that the areas above Satluj are called as the Trans-Satluj, and the areas down Satluj are called as the Cis-Satluj areas, right? So obviously, British checked his advancement towards the Cis-Satluj or the south of Satluj areas. So first is the Treaty of Amritsar. Now see, by this time, when the Treaty of Amritsar was signed, when we do his conquest, after this, he conquered Multan, Peshawar, Kashmir and various other areas. He took over the areas of the missiles also. So somewhere down the line, because right now, British were busy bringing other parts of India under their control, so they did not pay any attention to Punjab. But since I told you, by the end of 19th century, now they had expanded in the entire of subcontinent, and they moved towards the Punjab. So the first thing they did was they occupied Shikarpur. Now here Shikarpur had already been occupied by Ranjit Singh, but British told Ranjit Singh to withdraw the forces from Shikarpur. In 1835, they took the possession of Firozpur. Now because Firozpur was quite close to Lahore, they could get good information of Ranjit Singh. Now, if you could just kind of see the area, Firozpur here with my pointer, I will just show it to you. This is Firozpur, and you can see it is so clear, close to Lahore. So that means in 1835, they took over the Shikarpur. In 1835, they took possession of Firozpur. And in 1838, very important, they established a military cantonment also. Now, another thing they did was in 1838, then they also blocked Ranjit Singh's advancement towards Sindh, right? Now, this became a great bone of contention between the Lahore Darbar and British, because Sindh was always the area which even the Sikh soldiers wanted to annex, right? So, and they also forced the Amirs of Sindh, Amirs is a name given to the ruler of Sindh, to keep a British resident at Hyderabad. So first cause we have done, the policy of encircling, right? The Treaty of Amritsar advanced is Cis-Satluj areas, then occupied Shikarpur, Firozpur, military cantonment at Firozpur, and they also forced the Amirs of Sindh to keep the British resident at Hyderabad. The second is the anarchy. Now, the word anarchy means chaos. And this is what I told you in the very beginning, that till Ranjit Singh was there, he tried to consolidate the kingdom. He tried to make the kingdom strong, army strong, so that he is able to thwart the conquest of British. But after the death of Ranjit Singh in June 1839, anarchy spread in Punjab. It was a period of conspiracy. Killing for the occupation of throne started. Now you can just see, bache, during these 6 years, now Ranjit Singh died in 1839 and the war started in 1845. So you can just see in these matter of 6 years, as many as 5 governments were changed. Starting from Khadak Singh. Now, Khadak Singh was the eldest son of Ranjit Singh. He was made the next ruler, but it was presumed that he was poisoned and he died on the 5th November 1840. Now, Khadak Singh was succeeded by his son, Nau Nihal Singh. And it is believed that, he had come back from the cremation of his father, that a falling archway fell on him. And it was believed that this falling archway at the Lahore gate was something which was pre-planned. Then the next ruler is your Chand Kaur, the mother of Nau Nihal Singh. Obviously, she could not, when we talk about Chand Kaur, obviously she could not be ruler for longer duration. And that was now followed by Sher Singh. Now, Sher Singh was yet another son of Ranjit Singh. You have to understand that during these time, the Dogras and the Sandevalias, they were playing a very important role. And who were these? They actually belonged to the family of Ranjit Singh, and these were the Diwans, and they held important position. Now, when I talk about Sher Singh, now Sher Singh was actually helped by Dhyan Singh, Dhyan Chand Dogra, to be on this throne. But later, Sher Singh was murdered by Ajit Singh Sindhewalia, right? Then this was followed by the last ruler, that is Dilip Singh. Now, since Dilip Singh was a minor, so his mother Rani Jindhan ruled or as his regent, right? Here again, bache, you will also just read about this, that Hira Singh, who helped Dilip Singh, was also killed by these troops under Sham Singh Atariwala. So this kind of, you know, murders, this kind of, you know, murderous conspiracies, that had become the order of the day in the Lahore court, right? Right, now some kind of pictures to show you. This is Khadak Singh, this is Nonihal Singh, and as I told you, he was injured by a falling archway at Lahore Gate while he was returning back from his father's cremation. Rani Chand Kaur, and then is Sher Singh, and you know, even his son Pratap Singh was actually murdered by Ajit Singh Sindhewalia. And then you have Dilip Singh, right? And Dilip Singh was being held by his mother Rani Jindan. And at this time, the Wazir was Jawahar Mal, the brother of Rani Jindan. Right, so you can imagine that these kind of conspiracies, and actually British were looking towards Punjab, and they knew that Punjab is like a ripe fruit which is deemed to fall in their lap. Right, number three reason that we will be talking is the defeat of British in the First Anglo-Afghan War. Right, now during this time, the First Afghan War, which happened from 1839 to 42, British were defeated. Now, so long British were thought to be invincible, nobody can defeat them, but this defeat of British in the First Anglo-Sikh War made the Sikh believe that yes, that they boosted the morale of the Sikh, and they began to think that if they could defeat Afghans, so it will not be difficult for them to defeat English as well. Now, during this time, I just kind of mentioned it here. I was just kind of searching various books. Now, the letters written by Henry Lawrence makes it very clear that English in 1841 were tempted to annex Punjab, but maybe it was the Anglo-Afghan War which deterred them to attack, because they now wanted to be very cautious while they are going to fight against Punjab, because they realized that it's not going to be that simple a war. Then number four is the occupation of Sindh by the British. This also became one of the causes for the First Anglo-Sikh War. Now, in 1848, Lord Ellen Barrow, he was made the new Governor General in place of Lord Auckland. Now, we know that the Afghan War was from 39 to 42. So, in 42, when Lord Ellen Barrow becomes the Governor General, the first thing that he wants to do is that he wants to erase the disgrace of the defeat which the British had to taste in the First Anglo-Afghan War. So he decides to occupy Sindh. Now, the area of Sindh, I showed you in the map also, was geographically important, and the rulers of Sindh, called as the Amirs, they were loyal to British, yet false allegations were levered, and Lord Ellen Barrow declared war against Sindh, and in 1843, Sindh was brought under the control of the British. Now, on the other hand, Sikh also wanted to annex into the empire. So obviously that embittered the Anglo-Sikh relations. Now, when we talk about the Lord Ellenborough, you can actually understand that, of course, his plans of annexing Punjab was absolutely clear. His conquest of Sindh, his treaty with the Sindhia, the Maratha chief, the occupation of the Sikh state of Kathal in 1843. He was trying to assemble the English army at Karnal and Ferozpur. So that was, so somewhere down the line, their plans to annex Punjab was quite clear, and they were just looking for an opportunity to do so. Right, so this is the area of Sindh, right? And but this you have to understand, which is the first Anglo-Sikh war was fought more or less near Ferozpur, right? So we have these wars like Battle of Mudki or the Badowal, Alewal, they all were like around Ferozpur or towards your Ludhiana. Right, then the next one is the policy of Governor General towards Punjab. See, Lord Ellenborough, I told you that, of course, his plan was to annex Punjab. Now, he was replaced by Lord Harding. And even, you know, Ellenborough, whenever, as I told you, the letters that were written to the Duke of Wellington, it becomes very, very clear that his plans of occupation of Punjab were very much real. Now, in 1844, Lord Harding is made the new Governor General, and Lord Harding was the man who had earned a great name in the Peninsular Wars, in the Battle of Waterloo against Napoleon. So his appointment was yet another proof of the Britishers' design towards the Punjab. Right, and then you can also see that how these British were also trying to prepare themselves militarily. So when the first Anglo war that was started, they already had 40,000 soldiers and 94 cannons on the border of Punjab. They had prepared themselves militarily. Additional forces were sent from Ambala, right, and they moved very diplomatically. Another important thing is, Vijay, initially the political agent was Major Clark. Now you can see here, you know, Major Clark was replaced by Major Broadfoot. Now Clark, you know, whenever you read different books, you'll feel that Clark had some kind of, you know, soft, you know, heart towards the Punjab. So they wanted to have a person with a very strong feeling towards Punjab, and that was Major Broadfoot. He tried to divide the Sikh nobles and also tried to create those conditions which might induce the Sikh to declare war against the Sikh. No doubt it was Bradford who instigated Tej Singh and Gulab Singh to cross the river Satluj with the Sikh army, which eventually resulted in the war, right? Then his appointment of this Major Broadfoot, as I told you, Vache, that before him, it was Mr. Clark, who was the political agent of Ludhiana. He was replaced by Broadfoot. Now, Dr. Foja Singh, an eminent historian on the history of Punjab, he writes that appointment of Broadfoot as a political agent at Ludhiana was also a calculated move and made with an eye on the fast approaching war with Punjab. That means that was clear that war is going to happen. Now, Broadfoot also took certain exercises which provoke the Sikh against the British. Now, as I told you, Bache, not all the areas of beyond Satluj came under the British protection. There were certain areas which still remained under Ranjit Singh, and he was collecting taxes from there. So in March 1845, the war starts in December. Now, March 1845, Lal Singh had gone to the areas across Satluj to collect the revenue. So while he crossed the Satluj, Major Broadfoot did not like his crossing of Satluj without his permission. So he ordered Lal Singh to go back. Now here Lal Singh did not want to clash with Major Broadfoot. So hardly had his boat left that Broadfoot, along with his aide Robert Cusk, they chased them and they detained their last boat. Now here Lal Singh acted very wisely. In case he would not have acted wisely, then that one shot would have provided the first shot of the Great Sikh War. Right. Now, this is also, I kind of found on the internet, this wasn't in my book, that there were certain disagreements between the Lahore Darbar and British. One was the question of the Sucheth Singh's treasury. Now, who was Sucheth Singh? He was a Dogra chief. He was in the service of Lahore Darbar. Now, in 1844, he died and he left a treasury of 15 lakh rupee at Ferozpur. Now, Sucheth Singh did not have any son. So, obviously, Lahore government, they tried to assert their right over the treasures. But now British wanted to claim to settle the claim through the court, and this also made Sikh suspicious of the intentions of British. Another important disagreement was over the village Mohra. Now this village Mohra was situated in the Nabha state, right? And this particular village was given to Ranjit Singh by the ruler of Nabha named Jaswant Singh. Now, so Jaswant Singh gave this land to Maharaja Ranjit Singh, who in turn gave this land to the one known as Dhanna Singh. Now, this was okay here, that was perfectly fine. But now the ruler of Nabha changed. From Jaswant Singh, it was Devinder Singh, and he wanted to get back this village from Dhanna Singh. So obviously, Lahore government opposed this. Now, British favored the ruler of Nabha, who was under their protection. So this also became a bone of contention between the two, right? So now here we can understand that British was using every means to instigate the Sikh to declare war. And, you know, this actually happened, right? But even then, even when they crossed the river Satluj, they did not declare the war, yet it declared that it would not cross Satluj if English army would not proceed ahead of Ludhiana and Ferozpur. Now, since Pache, British were already, they were already prepared for their for the war. So they availed this opportunity, they ordered their armies to move forward from Ambala and Meerut, and the Sikh army crossed Satluj on December 13, and the crossing of the river Satluj by Sikh army gave the English the necessary pretext, and Lord Harding declared the war. The last topic in the causes we'll be doing is the incitement of war by Lal Singh and Tej Singh. Now, as I told you, bache, when Daleep Singh was made the Maharaja of Punjab, because he was a minor, his regent, his mother Rani Jind Kaur, was ruling on his behalf. So she had made her brother Jawahar Singh as the Wazir. But Jawahar Singh was murdered, and later Lal Singh was appointed as the new Wazir, and Tej Singh was appointed as the commander of the Khalsa army. Now, both of them feared the Khalsa army. They were constantly in league with the British because they wanted to weaken the power of the Khalsa army. They always feared that if Khalsa army becomes powerful, they might not retain their position. Now, above is the photo of Lal Singh, the Prime Minister, and Tej Singh, the Commander-in-Chief, and they were in league with the British. So before we go on to start with the events, let's just quickly revise the causes that we have done, right? Number one I did was the British policy of encircling Punjab, of the Treaty of Lahore. They curtailed the Ranjit Singh's check towards the south of Satluj areas, Shikarpur, Ferozpur, military cantonment in Ferozpur. And then in 38, they also kept a British resident at Hyderabad, right? Then a total anarchy in Punjab, as I told you, from Khadak Singh, Nonihal Singh, Chand Singh, Sher Singh, Daleep Singh. There were these change of various governments during these 6 years. Then British were defeated in the first Anglo-Afghan war, and they wanted to avenge this defeat by winning the war against Punjab. Then occupation of Sindh. See, occupation of Sindh was the direct cause for this war, because aap ye dekho bache, ek miya mein do talwarein nahi reh sakti hai. Now, you know, at one part. You can't have two, you know, rulers together. When you're occupying sin, that means you're challenging the power of the Sikh, and that could be only decided by war. So in 42, Lord Ellenborough, he replaced Lord Auckland, and he wanted to erase the disgrace of the defeat, and so he wanted to occupy Sindh. In 1843, it was occupied, but Lord Ellenborough, it becomes absolutely clear, his conquest of Sindh, the treaty with the Sindhias, occupation of the Sikh state of Kathal, the assembling of the English army at Karnal and Ferozpur, that the first Anglo-Sikh war was in his plan, right? As I told you, the area of Sindh, and this war was near Ferozpur only. Right, then in now the new Governor General Lord Hardinge, who has this name in the Peninsular War, in the Battle of Waterloo against Napoleon. So bringing such kind of person here was an absolute proof of the designs of British towards Punjab. Right, then you know Major Broadfoot was deputed to Punjab as the political agent of English, and he tried to instigate both Tej Singh and Gulab Singh to cross River Satluj, and that meant that the war could be started, because they have not followed the Treaty of Amritsar, right? Then, as I told you about Major Broadfoot, then the question of Sucheth Singh's treasury, disagreement over village Mohra, and finally the incitement to war by Lal Singh and Tej Singh. Now, while I was kind of reading another interesting book, it has also been mentioned that maybe during this time, Rani Jind Kaur also was a part of this thing. That remains a kind of a mystery, because that still needs to be found. But of course, the incitement of war was done by Lal Singh and Tej Singh. All right, now let's move on to the events. Now, before I move on to the events, let me just see how much of time have I utilized. Do I need to have a part two, or should we just carry on with this alone? Okay, so we have used about 25 minutes. So I will be doing the whole video, I think, here. So let me now talk about the events. Now, many of you might feel that the first Anglo-Sikh war just means one war fought between the two Wula, and what is the result? Okay, the Sikhs are defeated, that's it. But that's not correct. The first Anglo-Sikh war actually had five wars which were fought. Now let's talk about the first battle, the Battle of Mudki. That was a small village near Ferozpur, and that was fought on the 18th December 1845. Then the Battle of Ferozpur, 2 days after the Battle of Mudki on 21st December. Then there is a break of 1 month, and then is the Battle of Badowal, which is near Ludhiana, on 21st January 1846. Then the Battle of Alewal a week later, 28 January 1846, again near Ludhiana. The Battle of Sabrau on the 10th February 1846. So let's move on to that. Now the war begins on the 11th of December. About 50,000 Sikh soldiers under the command of Lal Singh and Tej Singh, they cross river Satluj. The soldiers reach Ferozpur on the 15th December. And at this time, the British army was being commanded by Major General Littler. Now at this time, actually, the British army only had 7,000 soldiers. Now if Lal Singh or Tej Singh would have attacked the British army here, they would have been easily conquered. But their aim was not to win, so nothing was done at this time. Right? So the first major battle between them was the Battle of Mudki on the 18th December 1845, where the Sikh soldiers were around 5,500 and the British soldiers were about 12,000. They were led by Lord Hugh Gough. Now, this battle actually, ab is battle ke bare mein jab bhi main, I just kind of read in the various books. In this battle, actually, the British sensed the power of the Sikh, and at one time they wanted to give up. But again, why the Sikh were defeated? Because of the treachery of Lal Singh and Tej Singh, because they fled from the battleground, and without their leader, the Sikh did not know what to do. But this battle, it served to dispel, to remove the notion that Sikh can be defeated very easily. They understood that Sikh were no great force to be reckoned with. They will have to deal with it very, very seriously. Then comes the second battle of this Anglo-Sikh war, which is the Battle of Ferozshah, which was fought on the 21st December 1845. This area was 10 miles away from Mudgee. Now, since I told you, bache, in the first battle of Mudgee, they knew that it is not easy for them to defeat the Sikh. So they called in extra forces from Ferozpur, Ambala, and Ludhiana, and now the strength of the army from 12,000 was now 17,000. Now, army was being commanded by Lord Hugh Gough, John Littler, and Lord Harding himself. On the other hand, Sikh army was being commanded by Lal Singh, Ted Singh. Their army was, their strength was just about 25,000, right? Not just, I think more than that. But then the question arises, why were the Sikh defeated in this battle again? Right? See, here, actually, the Britishers, they were fully confident of the treachery of the Sikh generals, and they knew that it's just a matter of time that they will win this battle. But Sikh gave such a baffling rebuff to the British that at once it looked as if the British, the empire in India, will actually be finished. You know, that's what they felt. Now, on 21st of December, the things came to a pass that British actually started thinking of surrendering unconditionally. But at this time, again, the treachery of Lal Singh and Ten Singh brought the defeat of the British. But General Havelock, his remark is very, very important. Another such action will shake the empire. So this is, you know, what can be said about this particular war. So we have done the Battle of Mudgee, we have done the Battle of Ferozshah. Let's move to the Battle of Baddowan. Now you can see both these battles, one on the 18th December 1845, 21st December 1845. Now the other battle will be on the 21st January 1846, after a month. Now what happened? On the directions of Lahore Darbar, Ranjot Singh Majithia, with 10,000 soldiers, he reached Baddowal. That place was about 18 miles from Ludhiana. Now here, because the Britishers were aware that the Sikh army was moving towards Ludhiana, so they sent a small army under Henry Smith towards Ludhiana. Now Ranjot Singh did not attack Ludhiana here. If he would have attacked here, he would have captured not only this important cantonment, but also all the ammunition and explosive which had reached from Delhi. So he lost this opportunity anyhow. So then the battle was fought about 18 miles away from Ludhiana. Now had he fought there only, because the army that was sent under Henry Smith was very small and could be easily captured. So on 21st January 1846, a battle was fought between the British and the Sikh at Baddowal. British were defeated. They fled away towards Ludhiana. However, Ranjot Singh here did not give them a chase, so they again escaped. Now, of course, British were defeated in this battle, but they moved towards Ludhiana, and there they got their extra forces, and this is what Ranjot Singh could not check. He could not chase them and could not defeat thoroughly. Now this is what happened in the Battle of Alewal. Now Ranjot Singh did not follow them. So obviously Henry Smith, he wanted to retrieve his honor by defeating the Sikh army. So now he was joined by Brigadier Wheeler. Now Sikh, they were just trying to prepare for this war by digging trenches, when surprisingly on the 28th January 1846, Henry Smith attacked the Sikh. Thus, the Sikh were caught unaware. It was a fierce battle. The Sikh were defeated due to the treachery of Ranjot Singh as he ordered his army to flee away. Right? And the last battle was the Battle of Sabrau. This was the most decisive and the most important battle that was fought on the 10th February 1846. Now, again, this battle showed the treachery of these both, right? Now, before the battle, 30,000 Sikh soldiers had reached Sabrao. So in order to give them a tough resistance, they started digging up the trenches. Now, Lal Singh and Tej Singh, they were sending every detail of the preparation to British. Now, in order to face the Sikh army, British had made a good preparation. The strength of their army was about 15,000, and this time it was being commanded by Lord Hugh Gough and Lord Harding. Right now, on the 10th of February, the war began. The Britishers attacked. So at this time, as pre-planned, Lal Singh and Tej Singh, they fled away. And while they fled away, now this was really, really the sad aspect here. They sank the boats loaded with powder and ammunition. So all the boats which were prepared to fight against the British, they all sank these boats and destroyed the pontoon bridge which was built there. So when without the commanders, the Sikh army was unnerved. Owing to the shortage of the ammunition, the Sikh guns came to an halt. Now, at this critical juncture, Sardar Sham Singh Attariwala, he took over the command and he rallied the Khalsa army, saying that Khalsa ji, do not bring discredit to Sikhism. It is better to die while fighting bravely than live a life of slavery. He said, unsheath your swords and pounce upon your enemy, either win or fall martyrs. So here the role of Sham Singh Attariwala is very, very important, and this is what happened. The Khalsa army just entered the battlefield with the slogan Sat Sri Akal. They slaughtered several British officers, but at this time Sham Singh Attariwala died a hero's death. The British were amazed at his martyrdom and efficiency. Now, the martyrdom of Sham Singh Attariwala demoralized the Sikh army. How long could they fight the guns? At last, the Sikh army deserted the battlefield. But as the bridge had broken in the middle, about 5,000 to 7,000 soldiers were drowned in the Satluj River. So again, the British were victorious. And according to these eminent historians, Hariram Gupta, Khushwant Singh, they feel that this battle is one of the most memorable battles in the Sikh history. Right. So this was all about the events. Now, this is the chart I'm about to show you. The question which comes to me, even when I'm teaching in the classes, that how do we learn so much? I always tell them, pictographic memory, tabular form of the information, is the only way that you can remember history. So write the battle, write the dates, it was fought between whom, who was the commanders, something unique, the result, and make something like this. So whenever you are kind of appearing for an exam, a just quick revision before an exam will be very much helpful. Right. I think in this video, I'll be talking about why the Sikh were defeated, and the rest, let's do it in the part two. Right. Now, why do you think the Sikh were defeated? Now, the first and the foremost cause, I think we all know, was the treachery of Lal Singh and Tej Singh. Just to promote their selfish ends, both the leaders joined hand with Britishers. The saying goes, if the crew of the ship gets ready to destroy the ship is bound to sink. And that is what was the scenario in the Anglo-Sikh war with the Sikh soldiers. Although they fought with a lot of courage, bravery, but the treachery of the leaders led to their defeat. Number two, see, we had done in the administration, the military administration, that the European officers were also the part of Khalsa army. Here it is believed that the European officers who were the part of the Khalsa army were also in league with British. They were sharing all the important secrets of the Lahore Darbar to British that led to their defeat. Number three, we cannot deny that British belonged to the greatest imperial power of the world in those days. Naturally, their resources were vast as compared to the resources of the Sikh. नंबर फोर बच्चे, वी कैन नॉट बट एप्रिसिएट द ब्रिटिश जनरल्स हु हैड द एक्सपीरियंस ऑफ सो मेनी बैटल्स. दे फॉट सिंगल माइंडेडली एंड ऑनेस्टली इन द डिफेंस ऑफ द ब्रिटिश एम्पायर एंड अंडर सच कंडीशंस द डिफीट ऑफ द सिख वर इनविंसिबल. सो आई थिंक दिस इज वॉट आई विल बी गिविंग यू इन पार्ट वन. नाउ जॉइन मी इन माई पार्ट टू. वॉट आर वी गोना टॉक अबाउट? वी विल टॉक अबाउट द रिजल्ट ऑफ द वॉर. वी विल टॉक अबाउट the various treaties and why Punjab was not made a part of the British Empire. So I'll see you very soon in part 2 of this video. And don't miss that, because as I told you in the last, I have the map which shows the events of the areas where these battles were won. So see you soon in part 2 of my video.